Right, Mr. Newsman, in the newsroom of the three. 3, 2, 1. Yes, it was us. We have struck you where you least expected it. We have bombed the mosque. Only in the days of the final jihad. What are you doing here?
Well, you told us to come round. We've just come through the back, anti-surveillance, like you said.
Yeah.
Right, well, I'm doing my tape.
But we're not bombing a mosque.
What?
We're not bombing a mosque. I'm going to say we're not bombing a
mosque. Look, I'm just doing this tape in case the plans change to bomb the mosque.
Yeah, but if they did change, isn't the whole point of it to blame it on Kufar, not take responsibility for it?
What do you know about it? It's my idea in the first place, not yours. Now, fuck off. I'm doing my tape. Go on.
Hello, buddy.
Well, you're here as well.
Yeah. What's going on?
I said he's going to bomb the mosque.
What? Did you say that, buddy?
No.
Yeah, you did.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, you did.
No, I didn't.
What did you say then?
I said I was going to bomb something else.
What did you say you were going to bomb?
Huh? Fuck off! Fuck off out of my house!
Okay, everybody, welcome back to another episode of Porkins Policy Radio. It's episode 21. As always, I am your host, Pearse Redmond, and you can find all of my work by going to porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com. Well, today we are joined once again by our good friend Tom Secker. Tom really needs no introduction if you've been listening to the podcast, but in case you're a new listener, Tom runs the websites investigatingtheterror.com as well as spyculture.com, where he hosts his excellent podcast, Clandestime. And Tom and me have talked many times before, and Tom, it's always a pleasure, and thank you for coming back on the show.
Well, thanks for having me back on, Pierce, and I've been looking forward to this one. This is going to be a fun conversation for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. So today we're going to be talking about another film, and this is one called Four Lions. And Tom, you, I think, suggested this to me a while ago after we recorded a podcast all about the TV show Homeland. So I guess just to start us off, why did you suggest this movie, and why will this be such a great conversation?
Well, I mean, I suggested it to you because we have a, shall we say, somewhat similar, if not at times identical, taste in comedy.
Mm.
We like a lot of the same sorts of shows and the same sorts of films. And this is just one of those that there isn't another film like this. I've never seen anyone make a comedy about jihadism, jihadis, in particular a comedy about people who become suicide bombers, in a manner of speaking. I've just never seen that done before, or in as much as I've seen the odd sketch or the odd comedy show that sort of touched upon this stuff. I mean, the whole notion of like the piss take of the jihadi video, the martyrdom video. I've seen that joke in a few places, okay, but I've never seen it done as well as it's been done in this film. And I've never actually just seen someone devote an entire feature film to that sort of comedy. And I just thought it was a really brave film to make, even aside, you know, whether or not you think it works, whether or not you think it succeeds, whether or not you even think it's that funny, and people's reactions do vary. I just think it's a really brave film to have made. So
oh,
I thought, yeah, I thought it'd be interesting to discuss.
Absolutely. I mean, for the first time I watched it, I was just laughing hysterically. Four Lions is a very funny movie. Some people might have to kind of get past the idea that these guys are jihadis of some sort, but the movie is absolutely hilarious. It's very touching at times. And like you said, I mean, there's just not a movie out there like that. So perhaps first we can kind of set up the basic storyline. And I would suggest, you know, if you haven't seen Four Lions, stop the podcast now, go to the show notes and watch the movie, because it is excellent and you'll obviously get a lot more out of it. But basically, we've got a group of friends, Omar, Waj, Faisal, and Barry, and later another guy called Hassan. And they're sort of four friends living in, I think, outside of London. And
they're in Sheffield.
Sheffield, yeah.
Sort of the eastern side of Yorkshire. And just to put that in context, I live on like the other side of Yorkshire. If you look up Yorkshire on the map, you'll see it's actually quite a big part of northern England, and Sheffield is some way from here, but not that far from where I live, which is another reason why I liked this film. That whole kind of that whole Yorkshire Pakistani accent that is very prominent in this film. I hear that accent. I've heard that accent my entire life, because, you know, certainly if you go anywhere further east into Yorkshire than where I live, there's quite a lot of Pakistani either immigrants or, you know, second, third generation people who were born here. And so that particular kind of accent and that particular twang is just very, very familiar to me. So I suppose it was easier for me than it might be for some people to sort of warm to these characters.
Well, I mean,
but anyway, carry on.
Yeah. And these friends are, I guess they sort of perhaps radicalize themselves, or and I think we'll get into that because you're not really sure where they're coming from. But essentially, a few of them go to Pakistan and have sort of difficult time training there. And through a series of, you know, sort of bizarre events and funny situations, they do end up deciding to become suicide bombers and more or less sort of carry out these acts, although it's a little bit different than that. And of course, along the way, the film is sort of discussing lots of the different, you know, terrorism memes, like the suicide tapes, like the training, bomb making, all of these sort of things. Drones are brought up several times in this. And, you know, like I said, the movie is just so funny and so poignant and so, I think, kind of spot on to a lot of the kind of, you know, preconceived notions that people have about this. But I guess before we start, I mean, Tom, who are these characters and did they ring true? You were saying that you're more or less from this area. You know, how did you see that?
Well, with a lot of ambiguity, I have to say, because while I know quite a lot of, as I said, that sort of Pakistani Yorkshire crossover is quite familiar to me, and obviously most of those people are Muslim. Pretty much all of them, to be honest. Mm. So I used to work on a market next door to a guy, you know, a Pakistani guy from Yorkshire who ran a market stall. And he was quite religious, to be honest. He was quite devout, not in a violent or aggressive way, but in a, I am going to try and convert you to Islam sort of a way. He failed, but, you know, he's entitled to try, I suppose. I think less so from my personal experience, but certainly from my research into the history of jihadis, the history of jihadism, I think these characters did ring true. I think there's a lot in that film. I mean, I know for a fact there is actually quite a lot in that film that the filmmaker Chris Morris, who is a long-standing kind of comedy producer in the UK, there's a lot that he actually just drew from real events. Mm. For example, the bit where they're driving, they decide that their original bomb factory is busted because because one of them rather stupidly lets one of the neighbors in to dance to some music while they've got all this bomb making equipment lying around. I mean, it absolutely ridiculous. Hmm. But so they decide the original bomb factory is busted. They've got to move all the gear to another place, right? And they're driving along in Barry's clapped out car that keeps breaking down, and, you know, and it sort of starts coughing and spluttering because he's, you know, he's revving it. He's really pushing it because he thinks that the milk float behind is some kind of federal agent.
Yes, yes, yeah.
You know, Barry just has this absurd paranoia about the authorities throughout the entire film. So the car sort of starts coughing and spluttering and it splutters to a halt. And then he goes, you know, clang into a lamppost or something. And this is based on a very, very real event that happened in the run-up to the 1993 World Trade Center bombing, where this complete dipshit, this guy called Mohammed Salameh, who was, yeah, he was pretty stupid. He was about as stupid a person as you're ever likely to come across. He somehow gets caught up in this plot to bomb the World Trade Center. He's just one of these sort of idiots who's hanging around in this mosque that's frequented by CIA people. And he and Ramzi Youssef, the main bomb maker, are driving along in this rented car with a load of chemicals in the boot that they're taking to their lockup to, you know, where they're, you know, building this bomb. And he manages to crash the car.
Whoops.
And as a result, Ramzi Youssef's so badly injured, he actually ends up in hospital for a couple of days. But then he's actually lying in his hospital bed using the hospital phone to phone up a chemical company and order replacement chemicals for the ones that they lost in the crash. So this sort of thing, this sort of absurd thing that you think it couldn't be quite that ridiculous, reality is actually, I think, almost as ridiculous as this film. Yeah, I think it rings true in those kinds of senses, yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think that it's very easy to watch the movie and to think, oh, well, this is so insane and these guys are so bumbling. But when you start looking into, you know, the history of terrorism and exploring different characters, you see that, no, a lot of this stuff is pretty accurate. You know, it's a lot harder to do all the things that they're doing and not get caught. And people time and time again do ridiculous things when they're involved in some sort of crime. But let's explore some of the characters a little bit, because from the beginning when I was watching this, the sort of knee-jerk, Western perspective is you're going to think that these guys are just sort of, you know, fanatical jihadis, sort of along the lines of, you know, like a bin Laden or some sort of very religious person. And while they are this, you know, seemingly religious in the movie, I didn't get that exactly. And I was just wondering what your take on what motivates these individuals to do this. I mean, obviously Barry, who is probably my favorite character in the film, is the...
Oh, yeah, yeah. Barry steals the show.
Yeah.
He's the one white guy in this bunch, and he's forever trying to sort of prove that he's more Al-Qaeda than the rest
right,
of them.
Right, yeah.
He kind of feels he has to because he's got white skin, so...
Yeah, Barry, the invisible jihadi. And, you can kind of see where Barry is coming from, let's look at Omar, who's the main character, and that's sort of the, more or less the kind of hero. What is motivating him? And I have my own suspicions about what's really driving him, but it seems strange because he lives a fairly comfortable life with his beautiful wife, and he's got a child, and I could not figure out exactly what is motivating him.
Well, I think that's partly the intention of the filmmaker was to kind of not only completely undermine the typical perception of the sort of Western Muslim jihadi, but also to leave that question somewhat open as to, you know, is it one single thing that motivates people to, you know, to eventually fall into this category that we call terrorists? I don't think it is one thing. And in Omar's character, you do get quite a lot of different hints because he does, on the face of it, he does subscribe to a radical Islamic ideology, but he's not religious in the sense that, you know, the film goes to great pains to draw out the distinction between him and his brother. His brother is the really devout one who's obsessed with scripture and obsessed with his reading group, where they lock all the women in a small little room and then all the men go into another room and they discuss the bloody Islamic scripture all night. You know, and they're the ones who, in the ironic twist at the end of the film, it's his brother who ends up being busted by the police. Because he's the one who they would look at and think, under the stereotypical sense of what is a jihadi, he's the one that they'd look at. He's the one who's obsessed with the book and he's really religious and he's always going to the mosque and all of this. Whereas I think what Chris Morris, the filmmaker, one of the things he was trying to say is that's not necessarily who you should be concerned about, if indeed you should be concerned about any of this. But in as much as we should, because, you know, people blowing themselves up and killing other people is not a good thing. Whether it's ever actually happened in this country is another question. you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's not like this, as much as I think the war on terror is overblown, I don't think that, you know, these acts of violence are to be trivialized.
Mm.
They are quite important in a way. And so asking what's behind them is an important one. And with Omar, it's not clear at all, because he's not particularly religious. And he's also, most notably, not as stupid as any of the other ones.
No.
All the other ones are complete idiots.
Yeah.
They're, you know, like there's this bit where Fezzel says they're discussing what they should blow up, and Fezzel says, oh, let's blow up boots because they sell condoms that make you want to bang white girls.
It's
just utterly moronic, the stuff they come out with. Barry complaining, he says, you know, what is it, that line about Islam's in crisis, we've got women answering back, we've got people playing stringed instruments. this is what he...
Yeah,
he's worried about it.
And of course,
this is why he's got to commit violence. I mean,
whereas and Barry wants to bomb the mosque so that we could radicalize the moderates and that the Ummah will rise up. Yeah,
because and therein lies one of the things that I'm sure. I think we should deal with this off the bat. There is this running theme underneath all of this that what if Omar is actually working for the security services. Yeah. And I'm sure that's the sort of hint that you were getting at before, is that that's what we're ultimately left with the question of, is, okay, these other people are dipshits who have heard some crazy stuff and they clearly don't like Jews or women very much. But, you know, ultimately, they don't have a coherent worldview.
No.
That we can say, this is their logic, this is their reason for doing this. Whereas Omar just seems far too damn smart to fall for that. So we have this question. And there is several hints in the film that this is exactly what's going on. He's the one that's driving all of this, right? Mm. He's the one who, when him and Waj come back from Pakistan, they say, they make up this story about, oh yeah, we did get to meet the Emir, and he says we're on, and we've actually got this mission, and we're actually, you know, we're going to go ahead and bomb something.
Yeah, and I mean, there are also lots of, or at least I found, real-life kind of connections with 7-7. And I know that Chris Morris said that he used that, you know, he studied that case pretty seriously in the run-up to making this movie. And, of course, we've got Barry, the invisible jihadi, who has a pretty striking resemblance to Martin McDade, I thought, with the beard.
We could actually do one better than that if we're going to go down this route. Sorry to interrupt you.
Oh, no. Go ahead, Tom.
There is this visual resemblance between Omar, the guy who is running basically this cell, if you like. He looks quite a lot like Sadiq Khan.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
you have Hassan, who looks, who's certainly his beard and everything is cut to make him look very like Shahzad Tanweer.
Yes.
You have Waj, who looks exactly like Haseeb Hussain.
Yes, he does, yeah.
Could not look more like him, you know, unless they were cousins or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have Barry, the white guy. Doesn't look like anyone to do with 7-7, to be honest. But Barry, he does have a touch of the Martin McDade about him. He also looks an awful lot like this guy, Attila Ahmed. Sorry, Attila Ahmed, who was one of the cases I dealt with in 7-7 Crime and Prejudice was that of a guy called Mohammed Hamid. And he and his friends were successfully prosecuted under the Terrorism Act for supposedly undertaking terrorism training in the UK. And this was shortly after 7-7. In fact, that was made illegal in the 2006 Terrorism Act that was passed after 7-7. And Mohammed Hamid and his friends were the first people to be prosecuted under this new law. And what they were basically doing was not entirely dissimilar to what's going on in Four Lions, in that if they were jihadis in any sense, it was absolutely absurd. Because like the evidence against them was things like they had mobile phone videos of them going off into the woods where they were doing forward rolls and playing with sticks like they were rifles and mm-hmm. jumping rivers, and there's this one bit where they're slicing the top off a melon, and the prosecution's case was, oh, this is practicing for beheading and terrorism attacks and, you know, all of this kind of crap, and it's bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
This case against Mohammed Hamid and his friends is bullshit, but there is this one guy in the plot called Attila Ahmed who does look quite a lot like Barry in Four Lions, who is close friends with Abu Hamza, notorious MI5 informant Abu Hamza, and he is the guy who, at the trial, pled guilty to all of this, got a reduced sentence. He's already out of prison now. And there is a suspicion, of course, that he was the provocateur working for the security services. So I think Barry may also have a touch of that about him, too. Yeah, there is this whole visual resemblance between the people in Four Lions and very real people from the so-called world of British jihadism.
And I don't know if you've ever seen this, but there is a deleted scene where Barry takes Hassan and Waj on a camping training mission where they're rolling around and they're pretending to shoot with sticks, and you know he's screaming at them, and very similar to some of the clips that we saw of these guys. That the British security services used in a lot of these cases against the various 7-7 bombers and their so-called co-conspirators. So another very interesting thing. And and this might be a bit of a leap, but I actually saw Omar's wife, Sophia, as a kind of Samantha Luthwaite type character. For me, I found that she was the one that was pushing Omar the most. And
she does have that golden line about you were much happier when you were going to go and blow.
Yeah. And also, I mean, we see that, you know, Omar plays these suicide tapes in front of his child. He tells his son about, you know, more or less insinuating that he's going to commit some sort of jihadist act. He doesn't hide this from his son, and I found that to be, while this movie is absolutely hilarious, that was one of the more unsettling moments. I can't really imagine playing, you know, if I was a suicide bomber, playing my tapes in front of my children. And again, his wife is the one who seems to be kind of pushing him. She also has the most, she seems the most sort of Western of all the characters. You know, her name is Sophia. She talks with a much thicker British accent. And she's the one that keeps kind of encouraging him. So I found that to be quite odd. But what did you make of the his Omar's relationship with his family? Because I think at times, I was so conflicted. You know, part of you is like, oh yeah, you know, you're rooting for these guys to do something on some level. But then, you know, there is the scene where Omar's brother comes in and he is, you know, saying you can't do this, you're planning something horrible, and his wife starts shooting him with a water gun, and there is this really very tender scene where you see that Omar loves his wife so much, and yet his wife is willing to kind of push him into becoming a suicide bomber.
Yeah, it is a very complex thing that they're doing there in the portrayal of that family, because you're right, it is deeply unsettling. And the whole, like the running gag where Omar's talking to his son, and he's talking about Simba's jihad.
Yeah,
Simba, the character from The Lion King.
Yeah, against Scar.
And he's using this as this extensive metaphor for what, you know, it's never all that explicit what it is that Omar's planning to do.
Mm-hmm.
It seems that his family know that he's planning to do something and he's likely going to die. It's going to be a suicide attack of some sort. I found a lot of that very unsettling.
Mm.
I did find the whole thing where his brother comes in and sort of tells him he's not supposed to do this, and they all start attacking him with water pistols. I did think that, I mean, it's very funny.
Yeah.
But I think what he's trying to say there, what the filmmaker again is trying to say there, is that we can't reduce Islam to one thing. And that we can't reduce Islamic extremism or radicalism to one thing, or even just more, you know, on a more basic human everyday level, we can't reduce Muslims who are willing to commit violence to one thing, because they're not.
Mm.
You know, there's however many, 1.3 billion Muslims or something.
Yeah,
in the world.
Yeah, right.
I don't know how many of those are willing to commit violence for various reasons and various types of violence. But you know what I mean? It's a relatively common phenomenon, ultimately, you know, just in a statistical sense. So we can't just interpret this one way. And so I think he was, again, deliberately trying to leave that as a bit of a puzzle, but to firmly make it clear that he was asking the question and that he was saying, look, this man isn't just a one single idea and motivation and one trajectory with one conclusion, and nor is this family, and nor is his relationship with this family. So
yeah, no, and certainly
I think the aim there is also to fuck with us a little bit, in the sense that we like Omar.
Right.
You're right. We are our actual, in as much as we have anything invested in the film, we sort of want Omar to succeed for some reason. If only because we can't otherwise see where the hell this story is going.
Yeah, yeah.
right. That's the only logical conclusion. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of what we're willing to happen. And so you have to make Omar likable. And the scenes with his family are very likable. Despite the weirdness, there's a hell of a lot of love in that household.
Yeah, exactly.
That's ultimately what we're left with. So I think he was deliberately trying to leave us conflicted. I don't think that's a failure, of an artistic failure. I think that's entirely intentional.
Oh, no, absolutely, because, I mean, I kind of liked all the characters. I mean, I could definitely see myself hanging out with Waj. I don't think that would be, you know, he's kind of an idiot and a goofball.
Yeah, you'd kind of be interested in hanging out with all these people. I would particularly want to hang out with Barry, just because he gets given all the best lines. He just comes out with the most sort of idiotic, insane garbage you've ever heard. But it's the sort of idiotic, insane garbage that you could hear someone from any background making.
Right.
It's not particularly Islamic. It's more that he's a fool than anything else. That's the problem with him.
And a lot of Omar's grievances are kind of, you know, I mean, they're things that I understand. I mean, you know, he talks about sort of Western imperialism. He talks about this, you know, consumerism and how it's sort of, you know, they're always going on about, you know, things like McDonald's and just the consumer culture in Britain that just doesn't really seem to care about, you know, dead Afghanis and things like that. So, you know, he's the Chris Morris and the writers are definitely playing on real things. And I think that, you know, when you hear some of the things that they're citing as reasons, you're like, well, yeah, I mean, I guess I can kind of understand that. And I think I would go so far as to blow myself up and kill people. But they are real things. It's not like this sort of, you know, guy with a long beard and a AK-47 talking, you know, quoting scripture, which is, you know, it's sort of like what excuse is that really for something. So I think that it's all really interesting. And I do like movies where they kind of fuck with you and sort of, you know, lead you into this, you want them to bomb, you know, or you want something to go off. Every time there's a problem, like when they get kicked out of Pakistan, you're kind of like, oh damn, well, is that kind of the end of it?
Yeah, sure. You do want them ultimately to succeed. And that's part of the seduction of the film. And I think that's what you're right to highlight there in particular is that in as much as we get an explanation of why the hell they're doing this, Omar's reasoning is essentially political
yes.
rather than religious. It's not, you know, he is in fact quite opposed to all of this, going to the mosque and reading the scripture and all of that. He's not interested in any of that at all, really. And like you say, the logic of his argument, or at least the logic of his grievance, is perfectly sound. His answer to that is crazy, but you can see how he's got there. You can see how, and he does say some intelligent things, like, you know, that he doesn't just want to, there's a joke he makes about, he doesn't just want to be some nutter Muslim who blows himself
right.
you know, blows himself up in the toilets of some restaurant. And that's a reference to Nicky Riley, who was a young white man, in fact, white convert to Islam, who he was, I can't remember how old, but late teens or early 20s, young man with Asperger's syndrome, who was clearly someone got their hooks into him and provoked him into doing this. And he tried to build a bomb and blow up this restaurant. And ultimately it sort of went off in the toilets and he, you know, blew a load of shrapnel into his face, but he survived. And this was, again, around in the years following 7/7. So this is one of these rather suspicious events that very much solidified the British war on terror at that time. And that was the time when this film was being made. So, again, I do think he's very much addressing the dialogue and the stereotyping and the whole framing of the discussion around the war on terror as it's been in Britain in that period. And I think he's, I mean, this is one of the fantastic things about the film. He's not only mocking dipshit Islamic radicals, he's mocking the security state, probably more so.
Yeah.
And he's mocking the whole war on terror ideology and the nonsense that comes with that. That seems to be, if anything, the most fundamental target of this story. And that's why I really, really like the film, is because I think all of the targets in this film have completely got it coming to them. And I think he did prioritize them in the right way. I mean, a lot of the gags come at the expense of the Muslim characters, but ultimately you can't come away from this thinking that the government is a valid response to this, can
yeah.
you?
Because
the government
afraid
is, you know, just complete fumbling idiots, even more so than the jihadis are.
Yeah.
That is how they, you know, their entire portrayal in the film is as people who haven't got a bloody clue what's going on or why things are happening.
Yes.
And I think that's quite accurate.
Sure.
You know, I don't think the British establishment understand British Muslims that well at all.
No. And you know, kind of piggybacking on that, it seems at least we're led to believe that from the very beginning of the film, these guys are under some sort of surveillance. And
well,
this is
There's a bit where Fezzel blows up the crow.
Yes, and he's photographed doing that.
And then when Fezzel accidentally blows himself up, tripping over a sheep. in one of the most beautiful tragicomic bits I've ever seen in my life.
The the look on all of their faces when they realize what just happened, and Waj is still kind of smiling like he thinks it's a joke maybe, or something.
Yeah, like he thinks
he's going to be okay.
Yeah, somehow this is all going to be all right.
Right.
And Hassan's filming the whole thing on his phone, and then he sort of, you know, after a few seconds you hear him sort of, boop, and after that, Omar rushes into work and goes and talks to this security guard friend of his, who it's implied has some kind of police connections. Is that what we're led to think? And he asks him, you know, what have they found out about this guy this body that they've found that's been blown up? And they said, oh, well, yeah, they had pictures of him, you know, blowing up a crow. And so it's there's no way these guys couldn't have been under surveillance, even if we don't interpret Omar's character as possibly being MI5. There's certainly lots and lots of hints in the film that this whole thing's being watched by MI5, and at the least, they are just letting this go on. They're just letting this, right, you know, build towards its inevitable grisly conclusion sort of thing.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the very first shot in the movie, I mean, the camera work in the movie, there's a lot of use of, like, a zoom lens, and mm-hmm. you see them zooming in on the safe house that they're all in. And, I mean, I thought from the very beginning it's implied that someone is watching them, you know, and that, you know, perhaps the audience itself is a part of that. But definitely they're being monitored. And, of course, obviously they're monitoring Omar's brother. Which again just leads you to, well, if they knew that this was going on, I mean, how did they let these guys, you know, dress up? The actual bombing scene is, also again very comical. They're dressed up in these ridiculous costumes. They're running the London
marathon. So they're dressed up in silly outfits to disguise themselves as marathon runners. Yeah.
And yeah, it's just, I mean, how could you let these guys do this? Especially after they arrest Omar's brother. You would think that they'd have enough evidence to arrest these guys. I mean, especially considering that Omar's brother did nothing wrong. Also on that level, some more sort of creepy connections with 7-7. We've got the police killing two people, two innocent people, one in a very funny way with they see Omar out in the crowd running, and they think that he's in some sort of bear costume. And we've got one sniper shooting and killing a man dressed as a Chewbacca, who is a Wookiee. And then there's a long conversation about how a Wookiee is not a bear and that they're two different people. And we've got this police sniper saying, no, I shot the right person. You said a bear, and that's who I shot, so it's the right person. And then they also kill a guy in a halal shop when Waj is there with his bomb, and they think that he is the bomber, and then Waj, of course, ends up blowing up everybody. So another very creepy connection. Obviously, there were George Domenez, I believe is his name, who was killed shortly after 7-7.
You're thinking Jean-Charles Domenez.
Yes,
shot on the underground. Yeah.
So another, you know, kind of funny thing. But yeah, and again, the security services just sort of, you know, excuse that. And we get a great line at the end of the movie. The police shot the right man, but the wrong one exploded. Which is just, you know, just so typical of the security services and the way they can just kind of excuse whatever ridiculous action that they end up committing.
I think that is actually kind of a play on what happened with the Menezes case.
Yeah.
Because basically the investigations into that said, oh, the police were right to shoot him,
right,
even though he wasn't doing anything.
Yeah.
And then when they had an inquest into the guy's death, which is the only sort of court proceeding we've had in that case, and same thing with 7-7, incidentally, there's never been a, you know, proper trial. At the inquest for Menezes' death, the jury were told they couldn't say that this was an unlawful killing. They either had to say that the killing was lawful or that they couldn't come to a verdict, that they couldn't give a proper verdict at this time. And so the jury did the only thing they could. They said, we can't come to a proper verdict because there's no way they were going to say this was lawful. But right, that was the ruling the judge made in the case. He said, you know, even though the police pursued this entirely innocent man for the best part of, I don't know, half an hour, maybe more, let him get on and off a bus, even though they supposedly thought he was a suicide bomber. They let him go into this train station. Yeah. They don't stop him at that point. No. They wait until he gets onto a train, and then they shoot him and then pull him to the ground and then shoot him a few more times. Mm. And at no stage do they have any evidence against him that he'd actually got any kind of weapon or bomb or anything. And of course he didn't. He was entirely innocent. He wasn't doing anything. Now, how can that be a lawful killing? How can that not be an unlawful killing? How can it be lawful to do that to someone, even if you are the police? It's absurd. And this sort of thing doesn't happen very often in this country. So this was a big case. And so, yeah, I think once again, Four Lions is playing on things that have really happened and the absurdity of the logic that governments have employed to explain them.
Yeah, and the again, the kind of just satirical absurdity in this movie is just everywhere. And probably one of my favorite running gags in this movie is the whole rubber dinghy rapids, which I had to rewind over and over again, and I actually had to look it up online. What the hell were they saying? Because Watch's accent at times is really thick, and I didn't know if that was like an English thing or what that was, but basically Wadge gets you know, let's go a little bit more back into Omar. Omar is also kind of playing along the idea that he is perhaps working for MI5, he is a master manipulator of Wadge, and Wadge is always having these sort of, you know, doubts in his mind, like, is it really okay to you know, kill the, you know, innocent people, even if, you know, we're doing this for jihad? Why? And Omar is always there to convince him, no, it totally is, it's fine. You know, he convinces him over and over and over again, until the very last scenes in the movie, that this is totally right. And you know, he kind of helps Wadge along with talking about how when they kill themselves and going to paradise, it'll be like, you know, no line on the rubber dinghy rapids ride, which is at some amusement park near where they live. And again, it's just the most ridiculous sort of comparison to, you know, whatever sort of Islamic paradise you would get to if you killed yourself. But yeah, let's talk a little bit more about Omar as this kind of manipulator. And I know we've talked about maybe he's in MI5. What were some of the other little things that you picked up on that might suggest that?
Well, the fact that he is basically running this group of people, and that they are obviously people who, shall we say, wouldn't get this together if it wasn't for him. That's kind of the thrust of the storyline. I mean, none of the other people in it are remotely competent. In fact, that's their one defining feature, is their complete incompetence. And it's only because of Omar that any of this really happens. And you're right, with Wadge, you've got this thing where Wadge, despite being perhaps the stupidest of the bunch, yeah, he's the one who has the reservations. Mm. And right at the end, when they're dressed up, they've got the bombs on, they've got their silly outfits on, Wadge, and they're in London, and Wadge is still saying, you know, I'm not sure about this. Omar asks him, you know, what does your heart say? And Wadge goes, it's wrong, don't do it. And he goes, so what does your head say? And he says, well, we're here now, we're tooled up, it'd be a bit of a, you know, chicken to cop out,
right,
now.
Yeah.
So he's the one who actually gets that this is all wrong. This is all stupid. This is all for nothing. And at the same time, his explanations of why he's doing this, like, right, you know, shortly after that, when Omar's managed to convince him to do this, he ends up in this kebab shop, right? Mm. And he's sort of taking these hostages, these, you know, random customers in this kebab shop. And the kebab shop owner asks him, you know, why are you doing this? And he just goes, jihad man, kafar and that.
Yeah.
He has got absolutely no concept of what hell's going on or why he's doing this. So in terms of their relationship, Omar is completely manipulating him. In terms of the others, I mean, Barry doesn't seem to need any convincing.
No.
But the problem with Barry is Barry's got to be held back, because Barry has this tendency to, you know, go and shout his mouth off at meetings. Mm-hmm. And this is a bit where Omar tells him off for trying to set up the Islamic Republic of Tinsley.
Right. Baking a Twin Towers cake and sending it to a synagogue on 9/11.
Which is, incidentally, the sort of stupid thing that members of Al-Muhajirun have been doing for years. they've been trying this crap, and it's idiotic. It's complete, and it's never going to work. so there isn't any great threat to British society coming from Al-Muhajirun, but they do make a lot of noise, and that's sort of what Barry represents, if you like. And in terms of Omar's relationship with him, it's not that he's got to hold him back, it's more that he's got to push him in the right direction and stop him from doing it then, and make sure he does it at the right time, which is, again, MI5's relationship with Al-Muhajirun. They don't have to encourage these people to believe this nonsense. Quite a lot of them just believe it for whatever reason. The problem is, how can we get them to do the right things at the right time so that they feed into the war on terror narrative, and so we get this conveyor belt of prosecutable Muslims and all of this kind of crap? So if you like, Omar's relationship with Barry is MI5's relationship with Al-Muhajirun. Whether that's exactly what Chris Morris was getting at, I don't know, but that's very much how I see it.
And what did you make of the... Oh, no, I'm sorry, Tom, go ahead.
No, go on, please do.
Oh, so, just the Omar's friend who is also a security guard that he works with. Now, I kind of just thought that this guy was just sort of, you know, like a nice, regular guy who thought Omar was real cool and you know, he enjoyed hanging out with him at work. But there is a moment at the very end of the movie where he bumps into him. Omar tells him, yeah. I'm MI5, I need your phone. And he instantly gives him the phone. He doesn't question anything about that. And there is this one of his final moments where he just says Omar. And he says it in, I don't know how to describe it really, but he, if you watch the movie, he says it in this very odd sort of a way, almost like it's a, you know, some sort of keyword or something. But he says it in this very kind of dead, I can't really describe it, but this very dead kind of way, and his eyes like have this sort of dead look in them. And Omar then just walks into a pharmacy, and that's probably the most horrific, one of the more horrific explosion scenes.
Well, and he ends up doing exactly the thing that he says he's not going to do earlier in the film.
Yeah.
So that's one of the reasons it's so sad, is that I think the implication there is that he's blowing himself up. Because he feels guilty, about these people that he's driven to do, at least in terms of Wadge, very much so, someone he's driven to do this thing. Because he's so sad. And he tells him, he tells this friend of his, you know, tell him that I had a smile on my face. Right. And he has this really unconvincing smile on his face. Mm. And that whole, I mean, this is one of the things about the film, is it's incredibly well acted.
Yes.
I don't think there is a bad performance or even a mediocre performance anywhere in this film. And given that these are a bunch of people who, most of which aren't that experienced as actors, and this was a director who'd never made a feature film before, I think there's a real accomplishment there in just how gripping the film becomes. Because it does start out, much like Wag the Dog, another one we've talked about recently, starts out very, very silly and pretty lighthearted and just gets darker and darker and darker as the film goes on. And it does end up with our hero, this incredibly ambiguous character, blowing himself up. And it's really sad. That's the thing we feel most at that point, is not, you know, anger at this guy for being an evil Muslim terrorist. It's sadness that this is how the guy ended up, because it's such a waste. And it is. You know, it is a waste of life. I think completely.
I mean,
you're right to pick up on the friend. Sorry, but on the friend, because he is also a security guard. Let's not forget Omar, the guy we suspect may be working for the security services, works as a security guard, and his friend who helps him and who he says to him at the end of the film that he's MI5, and then this guy seems to cotton on that. Oh, so that's what's been going on all this time,
right?
And then, right at the end of the film, in the closing credits, he's being interviewed saying, well, did you know that he was MI5?
Yeah.
He told me that himself. So it's not like Chris Morris is just, that's a throwaway line at all. No. If anything, that's what the entire movie hinges on, is what the fuck is Omar? What was he doing here? Because he can't, you know, just like with the 7-7 guys, they can't answer the question as to who they were and what they were really up to, because they're all dead. So we don't, you know, dead men tell no tales, so we can't ask them. And it's the same in this film, that's what we're left with, is it's so frustrating that none of these characters are left alive for us to actually be able to say to them, what the hell was all this about? And instead, you've got this absurd scene where they've got his brother, Omar's brother,
and they
put him in this shipping container inside a shed on an airbase, and they say, this is now, you know, officially
Egypt,
the land of Egypt, you know, whatever. And through, you know, just through that door into the next part of the shipping container, there's some really nasty Egyptians who are going to torture you, and now you've got to tell us what your brother was up to. And he's like, I don't have a clue what he was up to, because he doesn't know. You know, he doesn't know whether his brother's a radical Muslim or an MI5 agent or anything in between or outside of that. So we're all left with this feeling that there's more to this story, but we can't quite figure out what it is. And since this film is so clearly based on 7-7, I think it's fair to say, I think he's ultimately saying that. He's saying, you know, that the war on terror is absurd, It's a pack of lies and stereotypes and complete misunderstandings of what's going on. And at best, the security services and the government are idiots who have no more clue about the world than the dipshit Muslims they're trying to fight. And at worst, they're the ones actually stirring this up.
Mm. And that
seems to me to be the message of the film, would you say?
Oh, I mean, yeah, without a doubt, absolutely. And Chris Morris also, again, kind of plays on that when there is a scene where Barry, you know, despite Omar's wishes, is at some sort of forum where he's talking with a bunch of other people, and we get this sort of a British counterterrorism guy who is a favorite character of ours from the writers of this film. I've also written Peep Show and The Thick of It, and this character appears in both of those shows, and it is absolutely hilarious. But, you know, he gives this British Muslims don't want to fight, you know, British foreign policy. They just want to get on with their lives here. And Barry goes on and on about how, you know, a good Muslim is a quiet Muslim. And in that scene, we first are introduced to Hassan, who is probably the youngest of the group. And he gets up and is saying, oh, yeah, you think all Muslims are crazy. And he starts rapping and then undoes his sweatshirt and he has this bomb on. And it is a scary scene. And he ends up, you know, pulling the trigger and confetti shoots out. And he's then, you know, and it is this, you know, ridiculous thing. And Barry is like, yeah, right on, brother. And
but we, just like the people in the scene, we're there right up until the moment when he pulls it and we see these, you know, party poppers going off or whatever. Right up until that point, we're not sure. We don't know, is this guy actually just going to blow himself up?
Yeah.
And of course, our expectation is based on the prejudice of the war on terror.
Mm-hmm.
Ideology and rhetoric and you know all the media coverage and everything in that our expectation that hang on, this guy could actually be a suicide
right bomb.
It would make no sense in terms of the film at that point, because it would presumably end up with Barry being killed you know, he's the best character, so why would they kill him off 20 minutes into the film? But even with that sort of illogical nature of that, we're still left with that presumption, and that is exactly what he's doing, is he's feeding us our own presumptions and prejudices and then displaying that they are in fact absurd. So I think that's a really good scene for all those reasons.
And I liked that in it, that, you know, then the security at this university or whatever starts taking him away, and he's like, oh, what, you know, you thought it was real, blah blah blah. And Barry starts screaming about how they're rendering him. He's going to go to Guantanamo. And you are kind of laughing because you're like, what, Barry, you know, you're just kind of playing into this whole notion. But then, of course, at the end of the movie, we see that Omar's brother has been rendered to an RAF base, which I found also very startling because, you know, we think that, yes, this does happen, but they're taken to, you know, places like Egypt or Syria for a little while or wherever, and they're tortured there. But no, in fact, they could be tortured right there in England in some shipping container that's quote-unquote Egyptian territory. So, you know, Chris Morris sort of throws that in your face, like, no, this is real. This is happening. And, you know, it might not be under the circumstances that you think. You know, this is Omar's brother is innocent. He did nothing wrong. But, you know, he switches it around, and then suddenly you're like, oof, God, right? Like,
yeah. I think that's another thing about this film that if you look, I mean, when did this film come out? Was it like 2008, 2009?
I think so, yeah, about that time.
So we're only talking a few years after 9/11, and we're only talking a very few number of years after 7/7, but the way in which it plays on that world so accurately in such a kind of rich and subtle way, I think makes it a real triumph of writing here. I mean, I don't think there probably will be a better War on Terror movie ever made, to be honest. I don't think I could make a better one. not sort of bigging myself up here, but as someone who's sort of been very much who spent years and years and years looking at this stuff and wishing that people would make more films about these kinds of issues and at least discussing this in a more, you know, three-dimensional way, if not a turning the whole thing on its head and saying that it's bullshit. This film stands out from every other film I think that's probably ever been made on this topic, in that it just goes way, way beyond. It's not like it's gone a couple of notches beyond what we've seen in other films doing. This film came out of... I'm amazed this film got made, to be honest. I'm amazed that mainstream money got put behind this film because it has pissed off a lot of people. It has pissed off the relatives of the 7/7 victims because they see it as somehow a send-up of the people that they think were responsible for killing their loved ones. I understand where they're coming from. I just think they're wrong about who killed their loved ones.
Yes.
I kind of think their feelings are misplaced in that sense. But I can understand it completely.
Why
they would feel like that. It's pissed off the government. It's pissed off quite a lot of the media. It hasn't got... I mean... The right sections of the media who love Chris Morris's stuff all gave it rave reviews, but it's not like the popular press liked this film. Mm. The tabloid press did not like this film at all because it completely showed up everything that they were doing. It made their job so much harder because they couldn't find it quite so easy after a film like this to just keep on batting out these stereotypes and writing the same war on terror articles they were 10 years ago. It makes their job harder in that sense. So I think they weren't so happy
no.
with this film either. As I said at the top, I think this was a very brave film to be made. I'm surprised it was made. I'm very glad it was made because it's one of my very, very favourite films. I cannot recommend it strongly enough that people actually watch this. There is one other thing actually that I do want to pick up on here that is another reason why I'm fascinated by it. And that's that the only person in the film who actually ends up being a suicide bomber in the conventional sense is Omar, is the one that we think is working for MI5, right?
Everyone else is an accident.
Well, yeah, Fezzel trips over a sheep. Hassan runs at the police saying, "I'm accidentally a suicide bomber."
Yeah, and Barry blows him up.
And Barry blows him up by remote control with a mobile phone. Barry himself dies because someone gives him the Heimlich maneuver. and Wadge, we're not really sure.
Yeah.
Why Wadge killed. What happens is you've got Wadge and the kebab shop owner sat there at a table. No one else is in the room by this point. The the hostage negotiator, played in a brilliant cameo by Benedict Cumberbatch.
Yes, yeah. Oh, I wanted to talk about him.
I'm not a huge fan of that actor. No. I thought in that he was perfect.
Yeah.
His completely inept fumbling attempts.
You're an ass man, aren't you?
Yeah, you're a massive ass man. What, you're calling me a batty boy?
Yeah. Right.
It just goes horribly wrong because he doesn't realize that the guy he's dealing with is completely irrational and stupid.
Right.
So you can't negotiate with someone who's irrational and stupid because you can't say, "What do you want?" Because then Wadge goes, "I don't know." He doesn't know what he wants. He doesn't know what he's trying to do. So what happens right at the end is the armed police all pile into this kebab shop. They shoot the kebab shop owner because he is, of course, Asian. So they think, shoot the Asian guy.
Yeah.
And then all we see is from outside of it that the bomb blows up. And it's implied that Wadge has just done this because he doesn't know what he's doing. So he is perhaps an intentional, if you like, suicide bomber. But it comes with a big kind of footnote, that one, doesn't it? In that it's not, you know, does he actually push the button?
Right.
We never see him push the button, so we're never sure. And then right at the end, you've got Omar, who is presumably the MI5 guy. And he's the only one who sort of unambiguously, we can see he did go and blow himself up. That's the only way that scene makes sense. He went and just said, "Screw it, I'm dead." So it's also playing on this, the literature and cinema of unintentional or accidental suicide bombings, which is quite a considerable one, much more than you might think. And one I've been obsessed with for years, coming out of the 7/7 thing and seeing the parallels between 7/7 and this bizarre incident with this French anarchist in the 1890s, Marshal Bourdin, and how that got retold in The Secret Agent by Joseph Conrad, and how that then got adapted into a Hitchcock movie. This is something that is going on in the British literary tradition around terrorism. And I don't know if Chris Morris had read these things or seen these films or whatever, but he is very much, whether he knows it or not, situating this film in that same sort of string, that same thread that's running throughout some very interesting artworks. So, yeah, that's another reason why I'm fascinated by it.
Oh, absolutely. Well, in wrapping this up, Tom, every time we've discussed movies or TV shows or any sort of thing like that, we always talk about, you know, is this a moral? Are these people moral? What are their actions moral? You know, what is the overall message? So I guess, you know, how do you see the movie, morally speaking? You know, is Omar a good person, or is he, you know, very sort of, you know, it's not black and white as to what he is. But what was that kind of takeaway at the end of the movie for you?
I think we are supposed to, I don't think we're supposed to like Omar. I think we're supposed to sympathize with him.
Mm.
Because either way, which whatever Omar is, whether he's just a confused, angry man who takes some bad decisions, or if he's some kind of MI5 agent tasked with entrapping and setting up these guys to become suicide bombers, either way, it's a pretty miserable life a lot of the time. Most of the sadness in the film revolves around him.
Mm.
So, despite it being a comedy and him being a protagonist, it ends with him killing himself, and it's really, really sad. And so I think, yeah, our sympathies are supposed to lie with him, or at least lie with him in the sense that we don't want him. We didn't want this to happen. You know, the whole film was sort of willing them to do something.
Right.
And to end this fucking craziness by actually doing something rather right. than just constantly engaging in crazy talk about it. But when it actually happens, we're like, that was terrible. That was the worst thing that could have happened.
Mm.
So I think the feeling we're left with at the end of the film is that, once again, all of our prejudices and expectations have been flipped on their head once more. And it is very ambiguous what we're supposed to think. It's extremely ambiguous what we're supposed to think about these guys and what they do. It's clear that he's sending up all of these things. It's clear that he's very much mocking the war on terror paradigm and ideology and rhetoric. But what we're then supposed to replace that with, well, I suppose that's it, isn't it? What we're supposed to replace that with, and what we're supposed to counter that with, is the fact that even if this guy is either an Islamic fundamentalist or an MI5 agent, or both, we can still have sympathy for him.
Yeah.
We can still have ordinary human sympathy for him. I would say that's the, if you like, the moral message of the film, is that the way you resolve the craziness of the war on terror is to realize that you actually have an awful lot in common with the person that you think is your enemy, and you actually can sympathize with the person that you think is your enemy. So maybe that is ultimately what he was trying to say.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. I think that if anything, this movie, you know, through the use of comedy and other things, it does humanize these people to an extent that you never really see. You know, we just think of these as, you know, of Islamic jihadis as these violent, horrible people. But as we've talked about, I mean, Omar loves his family. And I found the most devastating scene in the movie is when he goes to the hospital that his wife works at. And he, I guess...
Yeah, when they're on their way down to
yeah,
London.
And he gives her this sort of coded message that he's going to do it. And there is this look on both of their faces where they, you know... It almost seems like they both want to say no, you know, don't do this. But I guess, you know, they've already committed to this so much. And that scene was just absolutely devastating. Just so sad and awful. And there's this look on Omar's wife's face where it almost seems like maybe I went too far with this, and maybe we got kind of caught up in all of this. And I think that's really important in humanizing these people. And while they might do horrific things, they're still regular people. They still love their children. They still, you know, joke around and have fun and are fun people to be around. And I think that's really important in the overall message of this movie, and why it's so fabulous, and why I think everyone should, you know, go out and see this. I'm so glad you recommended this to me, Tom.
Well, yeah, I thought it would be right up your street. And anyone who likes that sort of particular blend of extremely silly but very clever comedy, which is something that British comedy does pretty well,
yeah.
Or at least the best of British comedy does pretty well. The worst of British comedy is as bad as anything out
there. Right.
But yeah, I think this film is extremely unusual and extremely rare that someone could... That someone would conceive of making this film, let alone that it would get made and get mainstream attention and get a mainstream distribution deal. I think that is something to be happy about. And I think that this film certainly does far more good than it possibly does harm. I think the moral message of the film is actually one that I ultimately quite agree with, even though some people would say he kind of softballs the potential state-sponsored false flag element of this story. I don't think he does. I think he puts it in the way that that's because that's all we really get. In this country, that is all we get, is the odd little hint here and there. Even after spending, you know, however many years investigating 7-7, I still couldn't point you to one thing that convincingly demonstrates that this was an MI5 operation. I could just point you to lots and lots and lots of little hints. So I think he's sort of textured it in the right way, because you can't come away from the film not thinking that that's a possibility, but you also can't come away from the film thinking that's exactly what he wanted us to think. So he's left it there tantalizing that, you know, there is a possibility this whole thing is, if you like, needs to be turned upside down once more. Having spent the whole film turning your prejudices and ideas upside down, he then gives you another kick at the end and tells you maybe there's another dimension to this entirely. So I think it's a fantastic movie, and I really, really do hope that anyone who hasn't seen it goes and watches it, because you, if nothing else, you'll laugh your ass off.
Definitely, yeah.
Because it's hysterically funny. And even if you get nothing more out of it than that, that's better than probably whatever else.
Right, I mean, yeah, with you know, movies only being remakes or sequels, this is just so great. So, yeah, definitely go to the show notes. I'll provide a link to a really good copy of it online so you can watch it. Tom, is there anything else you wanted to mention before we wrap up? You know, I was thinking just briefly of the fact that they end up, you find out that they killed Bin Laden at the end by accident.
And bearing in mind this film came before the official killing.
Yes, right, exactly.
But I don't think that's in any way predictive programming.
No,
because the scenario is, shall we say, very, very different.
Right.
I won't ruin it.
Yeah,
for anyone
who
hasn't seen the film by that point, because we've ruined enough about this film.
Yeah.
For anyone who's not seen it. But that joke is a good one. Yeah, I think once again, that's just him saying, and just in case, you know, we hadn't ticked off enough war on terror and sent them up in a ludicrous way, here's one last one. Here's a joke about Osama bin Laden, who's probably dead anyway.
Right.
You know,
and has been.
So, and has been for a long time, yes. And never was the man that we thought he was anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think the way that the film wraps up with those little clips in between the credits, they are probably the most revealing bits of the film, of the entire movie, in terms of what it is they're actually trying to say. And just in case you were uncertain whether or not he wanted the hints that we've been talking about, though they are intentional, those closing credits are absolutely confirmed. That is something he has definitely put in the film to, at the very least, suggest that that's what's going on, that this whole thing is an MI5 plot, which, in terms of the British War on Terror, it basically is. And so this is one of the this is probably the only film I think that I've ever seen that's actually taken that on as a serious premise, and so well done to them. And yeah, it's a great film.
Absolutely. And also, if you're unaware of the song Dancing in the Moonlight, it is just a fantastic song, and that is featured several times in this movie, so another little great takeaway as well. Tom, please tell the listeners about your websites and where they can go to listen to your podcast, which is also excellent, and you deal with a lot of the same kind of subjects that we've been talking about today.
Well, yeah, sure. My main website, at least for the time being, is spyculture.com, where I have a podcast called Clandestine. It's also on YouTube. At that site, I write all about the relationship between entertainment culture and the intelligence agencies. I also have investigatingtheterror.com, which is a somewhat, if you like, straighter website. Similar sort of thing. It's a research site on the relationship between terrorists and the intelligence services. And so across both of these sites, you'll find abundant background material for why it is that I'm so obsessed with this Four Lions movie and why it is that I love it so much. So yeah, spyculture.com, investigatingtheterror.com.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Tom, for coming on the show again. And it's just always a pleasure to be talking with you.
Thank you, Pearse. I've had a blast.
Okay, everybody, so that about does it for this episode of Porkins Policy Radio. If you've enjoyed this podcast, then please do visit porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com. And there, of course, you can find all of my podcasts. You can find all of the various media appearances that I've done. You can find my writing as well. You can always follow us through the RSS feed or through email blasts. You can also follow me on Twitter, at Porkins Policy. And please, please do subscribe to my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/1138Porkins. Well, as I said again, thank you so much for listening. And if you do enjoy the show, then please do help spread the word. You know, put it up on your social media, email it to a friend, or simply just tell someone about it. It helps me out so, so much, and it is greatly appreciated. And again, just to wrap up, we've been getting some great feedback from the listeners. So again, thank you so much for your emails. Thank you, everybody who has been subscribing in the past couple of weeks. And if you're looking to listen to a little bit more of me, then please go to CorbettReport.com. And I was there recently talking with James all about Africa and the neo-imperialism and the Western agenda there. So once again, thank you so much for listening, and I will be talking to you very, very soon. Everybody here is out of sight.